where you're going for dinner?
You finally got me on the police.
Move down one.
That's because we only got four.
You're off, yeah.
Throw you off.
That was good.
All right, I guess we got pretty much ahead of time, everybody's here, and we'll start off with the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Should be a fairly short meeting today. Thank you all for coming, hopefully everybody had a chance to sign in. And fire exits are marked, and if you have phones with you, we ask you to have them turned off so we don't get interrupted in the middle of anything, and roll call.
Henry Hale.
Yes.
Chairman Revenue is absent, Vaso Lefaris absent, Roger Black.
Here.
Mary Ann Alexander.
Here.
Patrick Duane.
Here.
Alexander Forster absent, Stephen Einhoff absent, Alan Reese.
Here.
Drew Arthur.
Here.
Matthew Frazzo.
Here.
James Coffey absent.
And can we have a motion to approve that the notice was published as necessary for the meeting?
I'll make a motion.
And a second?
Awesome.
And vote on that?
Henry Hale.
Yes.
Roger Black.
Yes.
Mary Ann Alexander.
Yes.
And can we say that the minutes were approved and waive the reading of those minutes?
Motion.
A second.
And a second. And roll call vote on that?
Henry Hale.
Yes.
Roger Black.
Yes.
Mary Ann Alexander.
Yes.
Patrick Duane.
Yes. And full business, there is none.
Just want to point out that we do not have a full board, we only have a four-member board. So if the applicant has any objection to continuing on with only our four-member board, you guys have the opportunity to reschedule, just to let you know that upfront. The county, there's not, normally we, majority plus four, which would be all four if the county had disapproved something, they didn't, so we don't need that. I just point out that we don't have all five members, we only have four.
You want to read into the record what the county said for?
For the record, the county approved as a local issue with no comment. For this particular appeal, number 2168, Virgil Spermetta, 7147 Route 9, requesting use variance, be allowed to occupy an existing single-family home as a residence that's situated in a commercial district that expired use when a single-family dwelling unit is not allowed in that use. You guys like to come up and have a seat?
Sure, thank you. Give me everyone.
I'll go through and just give a background.
I'd like to.
So, this is 7147 Route 9. Just, this is the coming ahead corners here. You can see it's the red area there, that's commercial district. A little bit closer here, so right there where you see US 9, across the road is a house that sits in between Dollar General and then the mobile station just to the north of it there. So here's a different view, that's Dollar General there on the left, that's the mobile station on the right. You can see the house right there in the middle, small person. Here's kind of what it looks like a Fort Snowden.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Just for the record, my name is Tom Renee. I'm an attorney here in Plattsburgh, and I'm here representing Mr. Spermetta tonight. Mr. Spermetta is sitting at the end of the table here, and next to me is Derek Rosenbaum, who also submitted a report at our request to support the issue of a lack of reasonable return. I also had submitted a prior letter to the board just outlining some of the reasons why I feel Mr. Spermetta meets the requirements for a use variance. The board is well versed with those requirements, the first of which is that there is a lack of reasonable return which I'll talk a bit about, but Derek's report, if he touches on that exactly. The second one being the property is somewhat unique. The lot itself is a, I think it's a 70 by 150 lot, it's a very, very small lot. Can't really probably be used for too many of the purposes that are actually approved or authorized or permitted uses in this zone. The house has been there for quite a while. I think in the listing agreement, or not the listing, but in the assessment sheet, it says it's been there at least since the 1950s, and I'm going to think probably earlier than that. Interestingly enough, it looks like it's been used as a two-family. It looks like there is actually an apartment that's been in there. I know in one of the letters, I think, that I submitted, Mr. Scavita's primary purpose is to use this place as a residence for himself in the summer, or to come down when he's visiting the area. He would like to use the apartment as a rental unit, I believe. He can certainly talk about that. But and I don't know if it was ever approved for a two-family, Alan. It does seem to suggest in the assessment sheet that it could have been a two-family.
Yeah, I don't remember any permits or anything going there, so.
But
whatever it was, his grandfather, it is what it is, right?
Yeah, if you look at some of the pictures in Derek's report, you can see where there was like a separate landing and a separate entrance. And so it looks like it's been two-family for actually quite a long period of time. I know there was some discussion about this being obviously a pre-existing non-conforming use and when that may have ended. I think Drew may have mentioned whether it was at the last meeting, whatever, the water was shut off there maybe in March of last year?
Correct.
March of 18. No question, Mr. Scavita purchased this property in December of 18. At the time he purchased it, he clearly thought it was a residential property. He'd been told it was residential. The assessment sheet said it was residential. And quite honestly, if Mr. Scavita, I think, had walked into the town's offices in December of 2018 and said, hey, listen, I want to get a building permit to renovate this building, I think at that point you probably would have given him a permit, because it would have been a year at that point as of the date that the water was shut off. So technically, when he purchased it in December, it was within that 1 year non-conforming use period.
When I paid the taxes and it was residential.
Yeah. So it was still within that year. Now, he waited to get a permit and started doing work until this summer, which was after the year period of time. So at that point, it was no longer a pre-existing non-conforming use at that point. And that's what triggered us to be here in front of you. It's not essentially going to change the character of the neighborhood. It's been a residence there forever. There is a couple of, I think, residential properties, even though I'm probably not shown on that map, somewhat in the area across the street. So there is some existing residential properties, not a lot, but there is some in that area. So essentially, we don't think it's going to change the character of the neighborhood. The property is clearly somewhat unique. We don't think there is a self-created hardship issue here because of the timing when he purchased it and when, you know, the pre-existing non-conforming use would have technically ended. And I think Derek can speak a little bit about his report about the lack of reasonable return. I think, as I mentioned in my letter, because of the size of the lot, and it's been that size for a long, long period of time, it really doesn't suit itself to any type of commercial use as is permitted in the ordinance. I mean, and unfortunately, some of the permitted uses that might be somewhat, could somewhat be put on that property would be, let's say, a Dunkin' Donuts, which is unfortunately right next door, the Stewart Shop, which is, again, somewhat within 100 yards. It just doesn't suit itself to be any kind of commercial use or permitted use that would be in that zone. So based upon that, and certainly if you have questions of Derek, or Derek can go through his report to talk to you about the lack of reasonable return, we do think that Mr. Scavita meets all of the requirements to receive approval for use variance, and his intent would be to have a residential unit, but also to have an apartment unit in that building. Is that correct, Bert?
Yes.
Okay. Do you want to add anything, Derek, in your report?
Would you like me to just outline what's in here?
I guess I just have a couple of questions.
Go ahead, yeah.
Just because you said in the site plan review uses 1 through 4, 8, 11, 16, but I'm down the line.
Yep.
That they would not be able to use adult daycare.
The adult daycare, that's what, number one?
Number one, and actually assisted living facility.
So based on, so adult daycare and assisted living, so basically for that, what I assumed was that the size of that house would not really kind of outlined what I thought was the most.
All right, and then actually the child daycare center also.
What number was that?
It's number 11.
Yeah, so I think more so the layout than anything, just being two stories and not having that much parking. I thought that that really wouldn't work out that well, and the location of it.
Yeah, I think parking is going to be an issue with respect to any of these proposed uses, because you're going to have multiple parking spaces for any of those commercial uses. My property is really is just not that big, and I have super, okay, necessary parking spaces.
You know, there's some of those items, so I think that in some instances, they could almost survive, but.
Absolutely, yeah, I think.
Probably not really viable.
When I kind of looked at similar type uses across the town, I mean, most of the child daycare center facilities are larger, you know, old former schools or whatever, things like that. So just, it didn't seem to suit. But yeah, for a number of reasons, just the size and the layout of the house and the size of the lot itself with parking pretty much precluded anything from working there, I think. And then further on, if you were to look at the actual financials of each of those uses, you'll probably have to support it.
Just something I just wanted to bring out, just to be able to say.
Absolutely, yeah.
Because the first, the 1 through 4, 8, 11, 16, 18, 20, 24, 26, 29, 32, 35, 37 to 39, physically possible due to the size of the lot and or the building itself. Your 5 through 6, 19, 25, 27 to 28, 30 and 33, mostly for the lack of parking. That's what you believe, right?
The layout of the building and the parking.
The parking. And.
When you talk about lack of parking, are you saying because the lot's not big enough to have that many spots there, or because under a site plan, you're still going to have green space as well as these spots, and that's what.
Well, I think it's both of those, but what I, so for the, I did do an analysis of parking when I looked at it as if it were a business professional office. I can say that that was the one use that, you know, logically, if you sit back and look at it, you'd say that could be, there's plenty of houses out there that have been turned into offices. But the only place to park is the front yard, which.
Why couldn't you park in the backyard?
Can't drive between the house and the lot line. There's not enough room.
What's the setback there from that?
Well, there's about, I measured about 8 to 10 feet between the house and the lot line to be able to get to the backyard, so.
The full length, yeah.
10 feet.
The lot's only 70 feet wide to begin with.
So I mean, assuming that you couldn't get to the backyard, the only parking would be the front.
Is that the septic, or is it connected to a sewer out there?
It's a sewer.
Okay.
The other thing with some of those uses too, say for example, if you want to have like a child daycare, you want to have like a playground or something, that's another thing that's going to take up some spacing, or the green spaces Alan mentioned, which obviously there's not a lot there to begin with. It just probably doesn't suit itself really to that kind of use. And it also just got taken into account the some of the area as well.
Yeah, but to answer your question, they're both, I guess, looked at, you know, the amount of space for parking in the front yard, and then even if you could get to the back, how much would be available for, you know, the green space and matching coverage. But I put this together quickly last Wednesday just so we could get it on time, but I did go further and do some more analysis of income and expense if you were to lease it as an office building. I wrote that up if you guys would like to see that, but it just basically shows how much you could lease the building for as an office, which would probably be similar for a lot of these uses, with the rental rate,
sure.
And then the holding costs, and then the debt service, and it's pretty much, I came up with a negative $2,000 a year that you would make on the property. So
okay.
That would show the financial hardship or lack of reasonable return for an office use, similar to some of the other uses that I went into.
I'll open up to the public public hearing portion of the meeting, anybody here like to speak to this matter? And that's the mayor can close the public hearing portion of the meeting. And any board members have any questions or comments that they would like to go through?
Just, I mean, one of our concerns is if you're in a commercial district as a residential area, whether it's yourself or if you sell the house and somebody else is there, the protections of the residential neighborhood aren't there. Noise and traffic and whatnot. So that would concern me a little bit. Just, you know, the owner has to understand it and future owners have to understand it.
In other words, it's a noisy area and it's not going to be a nice, peaceful residential neighborhood.
I have a very noisy house, so I don't think it's going to bother me.
Okay. Well, I mean, even if you did have a tenant there,
yeah.
I mean, they can complain to you, but you know, we can't do anything because that was part of the deal.
Yeah.
Okay. We need to do a secret on this thing first, correct?
Yep.
All right. So, will the proposed action create a material conflict with an adopted land use plan or zoning regulations? No, a small impact may occur, moderate to large impact may occur.
We would go with the small.
Okay. Will the proposed action result in a change in the use or intensity of use of the land? No, it's existing. Will the proposed action impair the character or quality of the existing community? No. Will the proposed action have impact on the environmental characteristics that cause the establishment of a critical environmental area? No. Will the proposed actions result in an adverse change in the existing level of traffic or affect existing infrastructure for mass transit, biking, or walkways? No. Will the proposed action cause an increase in the use of energy and fails to incorporate reasonable available energy conservation or renewable energy opportunities? No. Will the proposed action impact existing public-private water supplies? No. Will the proposed action impair the character or quality of important historic, archaeological, architectural, or aesthetic resources? No. Will the proposed action result in the adverse change to natural resources, wetlands, water bodies, any of that stuff? No. Will the proposed action result in an increase in potential for erosion, flooding, or drainage problems? No. Will the proposed action create a hazard to environmental resources or human health? No. So therefore, we declare a negative declaration.
We need to have a motion on that.
Motion.
To declare a negative declaration, and Mary Ann seconds, and we can have a roll call vote on that.
Henry Hale.
Yes.
Roger Black.
Yes.
Mary Ann Alexander.
Yes.
Patrick DeHaan.
Yes. Jeff. So. All right. And if we go over what Mr. Renee pretty much drew was about realizing reasonable return shown by the financial evidence that has been presented. The hardship is unique and does not apply to a substantial portion of the district or neighborhood. The house has been there for 70, 80 years, most likely, and has changed around it already.
don't think that project showed any evidence of financial problems either. Mm-hmm. And this one has, I think there was a complete lack of that information in that project.
Yeah, there was a lot of questions. We actually stated to him to go out and get professional help and assistance, and he didn't. All right, thank you. So the motion would be grant this variance for the usage to go back into a residential use in that area. And I guess the main condition would be, are you going to try to do an apartment there or not?
Yeah, it'll do nice.
Yeah. Right, so.
You'll be proud. You're going to pass next year. It'll look nice.
All right. So that would be part of the, not necessarily condition, but something that would have the ability to go there would be the apartment. Mm-hmm. All right.
I make the motion.
You made a motion? Mm-hmm. Okay, and a second? Right. And a show of hands? And a roll call vote?
Mary Hale?
Yes.
Roger Black?
Yes.
Mary Ann Ellison?
Yes.
Patrick Duhem?
Yes. Right. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you, everybody. Thanks for coming out on a cold night.
Motion to adjourn.
All set. Sure, you make those motions right there, why don't you?
No, it just slipped some in.
No.
No, I got, Carmen got me a bookcase. I got another bookcase.
No, but I got more.
Whatever.
All right.
See you later. See you later, Carmen.
Give me the second.
Oh, whose money is this?
Oh, yeah, that's what he gets.
Russ.
Do you love the money down here?
Russ?
Are you trying to front line? Are you trying to bribe a public official?
I had to go get my mom some stuff and so.
Talking about me leaving stuff.
Do you need tips?
I think you're trying to bribe a public official.